is well known in the field of international public relations counseling. He has consulted with a number of clients here in the Portland area. He will address the problem of crisis as faced by public and private organizations and how corporations and agencies can respond to crises in their public image. Jackson has assisted corporations that have suffered sudden losses of product confidence, for example, by consumers or who have been hit by strikes and boycotts. He has counseled political figures and organizations that have faced scandal or credibility problems. So this is a timely topic and one that could be an instructive program for all of us. That'll be next Friday, the 2nd of October. Following Friday, October 9th, our speaker will be Lynn Williams, the President of the United Steelworkers of America. His topic will be trading down, good jobs for bad, question mark. More about that program next week. That program on the 9th, by the way, will be downstairs, but we'll give you ample warning of that too. Our board host this afternoon is Chris Olson Rogers, member of the Board of Governors. She will ask our speaker the first question when he is finished. Our speaker today has earned the respect and the admiration of Oregonians for his courageous stands on a number of controversial public policy issues over the past 17 years of his public life in our state, and it's an honor for me to introduce him to you today. Congressman Les AuCoin is a native of Portland. He attended the public schools in Redmond, received his bachelor's degree from Pacific University in Forest Grove, so he is an Oregonian born and bred, and a man personally familiar with the great diversity of our state's economy and culture and geography. He was elected to the State House of Representatives from Washington County in 1970, re-elected in 72, and he served as majority leader in his second term in our State House of Representatives. In 1974, he was elected to the U.S. House of Representatives from our first district in the northwest corner of the state, and he has served with distinction in that capacity ever since. His first committee assignment was to the Merchant Marine Committee, where he worked on fishery and environmental issues of great importance to our region. Subsequently, he was appointed to the Banking, Finance, and Urban Affairs Committee, where he became an influential voice in national and federal housing policy matters. In 1981, he became Oregon's only voice on the powerful House Appropriations Committee, and he now serves on both the Interior and the Defense subcommittees of that committee. It is his work on the latter subcommittee, the Defense Subcommittee, that we've asked Congressman AuCoin to focus on for us today. He visited the Soviet Union earlier this year. He has long been one of the most forceful advocates of arms control in our public life, and the events of the last few days involving an arms control agreement make his appearance today and his remarks to us particularly timely. We look forward to his observations on the current situations and prospects for a better future. Please welcome Congressman Les AuCoin.
Thank you very much, Charlie, and members of the City Club. It's always a pleasure to come back before this forum and to address this audience, and it certainly is it's the same feeling that I feel today. Before I get into my remarks, I'd like to make, if I could, a brief introduction myself. On this trip to Oregon, I'm accompanied by my wife, Susan, who's here in the audience today, and I'd like you to say hello to her. Your program committee asked me to give a report on my recent trip to the Soviet Union, which was the highest ranking congressional delegation ever to visit that nation, and it was led by the new House Speaker, Jim Wright, based on an invitation from the new Soviet leader, Mikhail Gorbachev. And I'm happy to accept this assignment, especially, as Charlie noted, when we seem to be having the prospect of a European missile agreement right around the next corner. I'm happy to do so because of that and because of the experiences I had on the trip and the impressions I have about both of those things and the effects they may have within each of the two countries involved and on the relations between those two superpowers. As to my trip itself, I could tell I was in for a memorable experience when, to my surprise, my request to visit Chernobyl was granted. Second thoughts immediately flooded in. I remember getting off the plane and Georgi Arbatov greeting us in Kiev. Norm Dix of Washington State and I had made the request to see the Chernobyl reactor. We got off the plane and en route, Norm said to me, "It'll never happen. Don't worry, Les." We got off the plane and Georgi said, "Norm, you want to go to Chernobyl? It is fixed." Norm and I knew we were in for it then. That unexpected flight took place on the second day of our visit to the Soviet Union. Two colleagues and I, Norm Dix and myself and Dick Cheney, one of the ranking Republicans in the House, lifted off from Kiev on that second morning in a snowstorm that almost ruined our chances of even leaving, ruined our chances for the trip. And we flew on two rickety four-passenger helicopters, the vintage I didn't want to ask about, rickety in construction, and we headed off into the headwinds for that crippled reactor that had become such a major international story. We had asked to visit Chernobyl for the obvious reason, and that is that in the United States, we here in the Pacific Northwest live next to the only reactor in the United States that has any design similarities to that one which had the meltdown at Chernobyl. And I speak, of course, of the Hanford N reactor, which has been shut down for $50 million worth of safety improvements. We fought the snow and the headwinds in those helicopters for about an hour and a half before we reached the damaged reactor. It's now encased in steel and concrete, and inside it is a highly radioactive molten core that no one on the face of the earth, my friends, has any idea how to handle. It's there for now, but the long-term solution is beyond any authorities' understanding and ability to comprehend. As we approached in our helicopters the Chernobyl reservation, looking through the windows at the landscape below us, I got to tell you, it was eerie, absolutely barren. I didn't see a single living thing moving. It was almost ghost-like in that respect. And we knew, without really being indoctrinated, that from what we had read and from what we knew about accidents of this kind, that everything we saw down below was poisoned. The food chain, the ecology, poisoned for God knows how many years to come. A sobering feeling, and particularly for those of us who are dealing with the Hanford situation. When we landed at the Chernobyl reservation, the radioactive levels had been reduced to tolerance levels, and we had that verified by the American side as well. And for the next amazing 3 hours, the three of us spent our time on the most incredible tour of the facilities any American officials have seen. No American officials, government officials that I know of, have had this experience. We saw from a distance the encased reactor that was that caused the problems, the death, the destruction, the long-term injury and pollution that remains to be the effects which will remain. We toured operating reactors in that reservation that have not been harmed. We were given a demonstration, a replication, if you will, of the loading and unloading operation of the reactor that had the mistake, which led to the meltdown. We were treated to a full briefing by the Soviet authorities, including the man from Moscow who was sent down by the central government to take over the operation there. And every question we asked received a thorough answer. I'm not sure how much they trimmed at the margin. I'm not an engineer, but we did get an amazing amount of material which government agency officials have asked us for upon our return, which we turned over to them. We also, if you can believe this, got a chance to probe into almost every nook and cranny of every other operating reactor at that reservation. And I was allowed to use my camera to photograph everything I set my eyes on that I thought it was of interest. And I want to tell you, that would have been absolutely unthinkable only a few years ago. Why? Why did the Soviets let my colleagues and me see this place of such embarrassing failure to them at a time when, in a country which has been notorious for seldom even admitting that airline crashes take place, that it could happen within that country? More importantly, why did the Soviets only a few weeks ago, which some of you may have read, allow three other members of Congress and one of my staff aides travel to Krasnoyarsk in Siberia and inspect that controversial radar installation located there? This is a top secret military installation. And yet they let the Americans roam inside and outside that installation for four straight hours. They shot 28 rolls of film, nearly 2 hours of videotape, and almost without a single effort for any kind of restriction. Why? Why, in fact, going to the Euromissile agreement, why, in fact, did the Soviets agree to the principles, at least, of a European missile agreement on a basis that they said they would never, ever accept, and that is no linkage whatsoever to Star Wars? Why? Well, the answers to the questions like these always bring you into the field of guesswork. But as a member of the Defense Appropriations Committee with some access to intelligence estimates, as an official congressional observer to the Geneva Arms Talks, and as a member of this trip who spent dozens of hours in talks with half the members of the ruling Politburo, which by itself was a precedent, I feel somewhat comfortable in giving you my own assessments to those questions today. I think the answers to those questions are that something very new is stirring within this mysterious and ponderous country. I don't know how long it's going to last. Nobody could. But I do know that something new is taking root. A leader has come to power in that country without the help of the Soviet military establishment. A leader who now sees a changing world economy threatening to leave him and his countrymen behind unless he makes major diversions and reallocations of his resources from the military establishment and into the domestic economy of the Soviet Union. And so Mikhail Gorbachev today is attempting just that sort of major diversion, major reductions in defense spending, and major investments in domestic growth. But this man, Mr. Gorbachev, clearly understands, as we do, that you can't make major military reductions of that kind alone. You can't do it by yourself. It cannot be unilateral. It must be mutual, and it must carry with it safeguards against the other side getting an advantage. And therefore, it must be done through arms agreements that are negotiated in negotiations. I think he wants also negotiations and treaties from them that will lead not just to the reductions of numbers of missiles and warheads, but more importantly, to the restraint on investments in new technology in those weapons. New technology that can put weapons, even though they may be fewer, into a whole new generation which carry an even greater threat. I think he understands that. And I found that fascinating. Now let me just tell you the flip side of the coin that I see. America has its own national security and economic security reasons for breathing space from the arms race as well. Our reasons are altogether different than Mikhail Gorbachev's, but they are every bit as important every bit as important to us as they are to the Soviets. And our problem is to meet, to be able to equip ourselves to meet an unprecedented economic challenge coming now out of the Pacific Rim. So for the first time that I can recall as a member of Congress or as someone who was a spectator of the Congress and the superpower relationship, I think there is an historic alignment of the sun and the moon and the stars and the political galaxy between East and West. And that results in common ground, shared interests. And if acted on, I think it has the potential of just possibly permitting the rechanneling of resources going to military competition into domestic ventures for the benefit of the citizens of both nations and in the economic interests of not just one, but both nations. Now, will this, in fact, all happen? Obviously, I cannot tell you that. It depends. It depends on a lot of things, not the least of which is whether or not both sides are clear-headed enough to understand the opportunity that is before them, and whether they are brave enough to seize the opportunity and to act on it. If they are not, it is my judgment that both the Soviet Union and the United States run the risk, because of the economics, of being eclipsed, each in their own way, as world powers. To understand the opportunities that I sense and I see, I'd like to tell you some of the things that I witnessed while I was in Kiev and in Moscow. My mind goes back to Kiev, late at night after a banquet in that city, the first city we visited. After a banquet about midnight, two colleagues and myself were invited to go up to the room of a high-ranking Soviet official who had come from Moscow to greet us and to be with us as we went into the capital city the following day. We went up to his room, took note of the fact that he had five rooms in his suite. We had only one room in our suite. The only vodka we saw in the entire trip was in his suite that evening, by the way. I shall not name his name because he would be in trouble because of the presence of vodka with Gorbachev, who has cracked down on the consumption of vodka these days. We talked about many things, and this Soviet official and the two colleagues and I have known each other for some time. And we on the basis of that, were free to get in right into the discussion. We talked about what our trip, the speaker's trip, might be able to accomplish. We talked about what glasnost really was heading towards and what this economic restructuring that Gorbachev is talking about really meant. To what extent was it being resisted and so forth? And we talked about human rights and the fact that there will never be normalization of relations between the two sides, with only the military side of the competition settled, but that human rights questions had to be dispensed with and disposed of satisfactorily as well. It happened that the three of us in that room, the three congressmen in that room, were by chance Democrats. And so it may have come as some surprise to our host when we told him that it was our intention when we arrived in Moscow to press the Soviet leadership on arms control, particularly the Euro missiles, to do business with Ronald Reagan and to walk more than just halfway to meet his position, to indeed bend over backwards to achieve that agreement, and to de-link Star Wars from that discussion, not because an agreement in Europe on these missiles by themselves solve any major military problem. They solve some, but not the major ones. But rather because if Ronald Reagan can do arms control with the Soviet Union, it sets the stage for whoever makes up the next administration, regardless of party, to be able to seek and achieve more broad-ranging agreements on a basis that will be politically more tenable on the basis of the agreement that he might be able to reach with Reagan. And I was fascinated after hearing that advice, with what our host did. He leaned across the table and he said, "Do you think Mikhail Gorbachev does not understand this?" He said, he's already thinking ahead. He said, he has no major hopes for larger agreements with Mr. Reagan. But if winning a European agreement can allow all of us to get past this period about dreaming about Star Wars, then Mikhail Gorbachev will walk many, many, many miles. Quote, unquote. My friends, that was April. 2 weeks ago, George Shultz and Edward Shevardnadze, this foreign minister of the Soviet Union, met in Washington, D.C. and hammered out the remaining differences on the Euromissile agreement. The details are to follow, but the major principles are agreed to. And sure enough, Gorbachev has given most of the ground. When our party on this trip met with Gorbachev, we found a man in whom we saw was all that we expected and much, much more. Here's a man of extreme self-confidence. He came bouncing out of his office with a Western-tailored blue suit, not altogether different than the one I'm wearing, as a matter of fact. Shook hands with every person in our party, sat us down and talked expansively without notes, without any aides, without any assistance from anyone around him, him on his side of the table, along with Dobrynin, who was the former U.S. ambassador, and only a translator. And without a single note, he talked about the history of the superpower relations, the negotiating history of arms control talks between the two sides, pre-revolutionary history in Russia, and expansively about these and a series of related subjects. The man's mental ability was self-evident from the beginning. And you had the sense of high-voltage energy as you saw this person talk. As one of the few Americans who's ever had this experience to actually sit across the table from this man, I was struck by the differences between the new leadership and the old, that which had gone on before, and some of the remnants of that old leadership that still exists in the Soviet Union today. I saw the old guard, the remnants thereof, in action upon our arrival in the Ukraine. We were met there by an old political hack who was the Ukrainian party boss, and he reminded me for all the world of another Brezhnev or Chernenko or some of the other fossilized, stodgy, ponderous folks we've come to characterize as Soviet leaders. And the way he received us, I think, tells the story. He greeted us, brought us into his offices, set the Speaker of the House of Representatives of the United States down along with his entourage, and then picked up approximately a 25-page typed statement, and without lifting his eyes, read it at us for about an hour before giving the Speaker even a chance to say hi. It was really embarrassing. It was really embarrassing, and what struck me was the response that was happening within that room from the Soviet officials who had come down from Moscow to meet us and to go on with us to the Capitol. They were rolling their eyes as this man talked. They were looking up at the ceiling, down at the floor. I saw some of them passing notes to each other. And then they were snickering when they read the notes. And this guy droned on and droned on. He is a caricature of the kind of leadership that's out, and a stark contrast to the people who are in charge today. And the difference between those two was never more evident, except with the instance of Mikhail Gorbachev himself, than when we met with the number two man in the Soviet Union. And this is a man most people in the West whose name they're unfamiliar with. His name is Igor Legachev. He had never met up till then a visiting foreign delegation, with the exception of a very, very small Finnish delegation. Our government today does not know very much at all about Igor Legachev, and yet he's number two in the Soviet Union, from all signs, one heartbeat away from supreme power itself. He was rumored to be a very straight-laced, stone-faced, no-nonsense kind of guy, and possibly a foe of Gorbachev's and his reforms. Instead, we found a man who was who was first a man of some humor. He immediately launched into what glasnost, openness, means. And in explaining that, he said, "I want you to know where you're sitting, Mr. Speaker, and your colleagues." Mr. Speaker, the Speaker said, "Where are we sitting?" He said, "You are sitting in the conference room of the Central Committee of the Communist Party of the Soviet Union." He said, "What's openness, if not that? We've allowed you to penetrate even into this place." He meant it as a joke, but the man had some force. But then he went on and put to rest, in the judgment of many of us, including State Department officials who were with us, a lot of the rumors that he perhaps was part of a reactionary counter-revolutionary force or a counter-Gorbachev force within the Soviet Union. Because he spoke with amplification about what Gorbachev was trying to do with his economic reforms and his openness, he amplified and put meat onto the skeleton and the outlines of the strategy that Gorbachev had laid out for the world to see and explained to us. And he went on for about 2 hours, himself without notes, very spontaneous and highly informed. I was also struck by the fact that Mr. Gorbachev spoke very candidly of the very real problems facing Russian society today. Drug abuse of major proportions, widespread alcohol addiction, corruption among officials, the lack of incentives to individuals and also economic units within the economy. And he even spoke at some length about the resistance they're getting from some quarters to the changes that they propose. And then here he said a memorable thing. He said, "You know, what we're trying to do, at least at the lower levels of the party, is to introduce some degree of democratization, some degree of choice in selecting lower level party leaders. And we're trying to introduce the idea of responsibility and enterprise in measured form in the marketplace." I took note of his stipulation that it was measured. But he mentioned that nevertheless. And then he said, "You know, what a lot of people have trouble understanding is that democratization means an increased, and also the reforms on the economic front, mean an increased sense of personal responsibility for one's actions." And I was amazed that I was hearing this in that room, that conference room, the party headquarters in Moscow. But he said it, and he said, "We're having trouble with some people. We're trying to help them understand this." He said, "Some need a lot of help. And if they can't be helped, they'll be gone. And if they're gone, they won't be back." And he said that in a way that made you believe him. You know, these experiences, coupled with a missile agreement on the European question, convinced me that the brass ring is there closer to us than ever, both for us and for them. A brass ring which, if grabbed, can bring real progress for both sides. There is always going to be tension. There are always going to be intrinsic differences. There will always be conflicts between these two states. But I think we have within our grasp a historic chance to restrain the military competition between the two superpowers in advance of those future conflicts, so that the most dangerous elements of that relationship can be avoided and be reduced. And I believe that there is a mutual national security imperative here. Today, as we meet in this room, there are 1,800 Soviet strategic warheads aimed at targets across the United States of America. There is a similar number of strategic warheads on our side aimed at targets across the Soviet Union. And combined, they have the destructive force to pulverize both superpowers and the civilizations they represent many, many times over. I think only a fool, given those facts, would say that cutting these insane arsenals on both sides won't serve to advance our safety as well as the safety of the people of the Soviet Union. Well, that's the security side of this equation. I want to talk about a new twist, and that is the real economic imperatives in all of this for both countries. On the one hand, we have the Soviet Union, the world's largest socialist economy, sinking deeper and deeper into stagnation. It is a basket case. On the other hand, we have America, the world's most powerful democracy, reduced today to the status of the world's largest debtor nation, and allowing, as a consequence of that, another failures in planning and performance, allowing our industrial supremacy to begin to slip away to foreign competition. And so for both of these sets of facts, each being lived with on each side, I say both nations need to embark on a course that can permit them safely to reallocate resources from nuclear weapons research, production, and deployment into the revitalization and modernization of their domestic economies. And I think the need has never been greater. I said that both sides have economic problems, and I'd like to examine briefly those problems from each side. Let's start with Gorbachev's economic problems first. His entire scientific establishment is almost totally absorbed today with the arms race. I'm talking about his premier scientific institutions, the best scientific and engineering minds in the country, most of the R&D and almost all of the new technology siphoned off, sponged off to the arms race. Meanwhile, machine tools, lathes, other industrial equipment which are used for non-military production, those are vintage 1950, 1940, 1930, maybe even worse than that in some instances. The result is a tremendous waste of energy, feeble productivity, and a wretchedly poor quality in the products they produce. My wife, Sue, bought me as a gift a pair of gloves, leather gloves, when we were in Moscow. By the end of the first day, the stitching had come out of the side of the glove and the thumb almost dropped off the glove. And that's a perfect illustration of the problem. It is estimated today that the Soviet Union produces approximately only about 1% of what it produces in consumer goods meet world-class export standards. 1%. And you know what that does. It cripples foreign exchange earnings ability, the ability to earn foreign exchange, and that's precisely what's needed in order to purchase either domestically or abroad the replacement equipment for factories and for the modernization, which happens to be Mikhail Gorbachev's number one economic goal. Computers. We live in an age of computers, but listen to this. The Soviets obviously have lagged far behind, but I don't think many people know this. Until 1980, they had not produced a single personal computer. Today, Gorbachev's long-range plans call for 1 million personal computers to be produced in the Soviet Union annually. But I got to tell you, they have a lot of problems to overcome to make that a meaningful statistic. Can you imagine, for example, how well those computers will work if the best engineering minds and scientific minds in innovation-oriented people have been siphoned off by the military establishment? I think the answer is not well. Even if they did work well, the telephone system throughout the Soviet Union, which you would want to access into to have a fully capable computerized society, is absolutely the pits. And it demands a massive investment to rebuild the entire network. And then there is this fact. There is this fact. Even if all of that were done, this is a fact that many of us also don't know. Most Russians today are not only computer illiterate, but they do not yet know how to type. Most Russians. I find that a startling statistic. And thus, I'm saying to you that in almost every sense that I have measured, the Soviet military establishment and the drift of their production capabilities has been dragged on and led by the military establishment. And because of that, the military establishment has consigned the Soviet Union to the status of an underdeveloped nation. Those are the economic imperatives that are putting Gorbachev today, in my judgment, in the position to reach for unprecedented arms control agreements with verification stipulations that would have been unthinkable only a few years ago. I want to say to you that I think America has an equally compelling economic reason to seize this opportunity. Our economy is light years ahead of Gorbachev's, and it's going to be light years ahead even if he's 100% effective in his economic reforms. But he won't be. But even if he should be, we'll still be ahead. But what we're up against is something entirely different. It's up against a competition orders of magnitude more complicated than what the Soviets face. Competition of the highest order, especially from Japan and from newly industrializing nations on the Pacific Rim. And I want to say to you that if we keep doing business as usual in America, if we keep consuming more than we produce, if we keep running up triple-digit budget deficits in debt to foreign creditors, and if we keep amassing record trade deficits at the same time, then we risk slipping into third-rate status as an economic power, and we'll jeopardize America's standard of living. And that's why major arms control agreements, which can limit the levels of military spending on both sides, which carry with them safeguards against cheating through verification, are in the national security interest and in the economic self-interest of every citizen, every person, every man, woman, and child in both countries. I want to tell you that one of the highlights, in conclusion, one of the highlights of this trip was a chance I had in Moscow to do something for some children at Vos Elementary School in Beaverton. Some of you may have read about this. They made a peace quilt. They wanted me to take it to Gorbachev. When I met with Shevardnadze, the foreign minister, I presented it to him. The quilt was an interesting design. The kids had cut out silhouettes of their hands, and the pattern of the quilt had these hands stitched into the quilt, each coming from both sides of the quilt to the center, and symbolically touching in the center, each decorated with the colors of both countries. And I gave this quilt for these children to Mr. Shevardnadze and explained the symbolism. And Shevardnadze looked at me and he smiled and he said, "The children always say it best, don't they?" 2 weeks ago in Washington, D.C., those same school kids were invited by George Shultz to come back to the State Department at our capital and present to him for President Reagan the other peace quilt that they had made. That was 2 weeks ago. They had no idea when they booked that flight that Shevardnadze was going to be negotiating with Shultz at the time of their arrival. When the appointed hour or the appointed day came, I went to the State Department. We all went to the State Department and found out, to our disappointment, that George Shultz wouldn't be able to accept the peace quilt from these children from Oregon. It was explained that the talks with Shevardnadze had actually spilled over. They were going so well, and that Mr. Shultz couldn't keep his appointment. So I explained to the children that the Secretary of State was negotiating reductions in European missiles, negotiating an agreement to try to arrive at the complete elimination of classes of weapons in Europe with the same man to whom I gave their peace quilt when I was in Moscow. And then I recognized John Whitehead, the number two man at the State Department, and I let him say a few words to the children. And I want to read to you what he said to them from the notes I took at that meeting in the State Department. Mind you, there are about 13 youngsters from Oregon, grades 1 through 7, who had flown on the red eye the night before to get there. Some of the little ones barely hanging on, but all of them listening. And here's what Mr. Whitehead said. He said, I had referred to the two men and why Shultz hadn't been able to make it. He said, "You know, kids, the two men are actually meeting closer to us." I had said they're meeting in the same building. He said, "They're actually meeting closer to us than the congressman may realize. They're meeting 35 yards down that hall. And then he said, I want to make you the first to know something very important, and that is, by the end of the day today, both countries are going to announce that all of the remaining problems that have held up a European missile agreement to cut missiles have been solved. And you are the first to know. And years from now, going on from my notes of what he said, years from now, when children your age read about this in the history books, you'll be able to know that you played a small part. Someone once said that the children are our gift to the future. I think that's right. And I think it's time that we work, you and I work, all leaders work, to see if it is a future that will be prosperous and secure, and that we, at this time, don't let an historic opportunity slip through our hands. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Congressman. We're grateful for your taking the time to come today and to share these moving and thoughtful remarks with us. We have time for a few questions. If you have written questions, hold them up. I see some of you are doing that. We'll try to gather as many as we can. Chris Rogers will ask the Congressman the first question.
Congressman AuCoin, speaking of historic opportunities, what, in your opinion, is the likelihood of this administration abandoning its Star Wars fantasy in an effort to achieve a broader strategic arms agreement?
I think I should preface my answer to that question by making the point that the European missile agreement covers about 2% of all the warheads that could be used hostily between the two superpowers, about 2%. And they are not the most accurate and quick and most dangerous weapons that are aimed at each other. We aimed at each other, our allies. And the real question is whether or not what we can do to get to deep reductions in the numbers of intercontinental missiles and warheads that are aimed at each other, because these are the ones that have the potential of doing the extreme damage, and the ones that potentially, if improved upon constantly, represent a potential first strike threat, one side against the other, or perhaps both sides having it. I'm convinced that the bargain is very clear, the outlines of what it would take to get a bargain. I think it is for our side to limit Star Wars to research within a laboratory or laboratories, and I think that's important to do so that we might always be able to know what's going on within Soviet laboratories on the same possible subject, but to limit it there by treaty, and in return, see if the Russians are serious about their offer to cut by one half within 5 years the offensive missiles that are each side are aiming at each other, and to reduce all ballistic missiles, leaving many others, but all ballistic missiles to zero within 10 years. I think that's the outline of the bargain. And to tell you something, as a member of the Defense Appropriations Committee, I think that's a bargain worth taking. Star Wars is today a concept. It is vapor. You can't kick the tires. You can't check its teeth. The president has a dream about it. And I think we admire dreamers. But I think we're dreaming if we think the world is going to be more safe if we spend $1 trillion researching it, another $1 trillion deploying it, and thinking that somehow it's going to defend us. I regret to say that as of now, although this European treaty may make a difference, up to this point, that I've heard from the administration, formally and informally, is that Star Wars is something that we're not going to negotiate. Well, let me tell you, if we don't ever negotiate on Star Wars, we'll never win or find out if we could win deep cuts in offensive missiles that are no dream, but are very real threats that are aimed at us right now.
Congressman, with respect to the tentative agreement that has already been reached, can you put a dollar figure in terms of what you see the impact on our economy? What are the savings?
That's a hard question to ask. I haven't seen the fine print, first of all. There is no fine print yet on the treaty. And I don't know the total amount of costs that would be involved in full deployment of ground-based missiles in Europe and what we would save by not continuing to modernize them and replace them as they grow old. So it's hard to tell. I would suspect that it's not a large amount of money or large savings. It is, after all, a modest arms control agreement, but important for the precedent it sets about reducing actual numbers, in this case to zero. That's a very important precedent. And to eliminate a class of weapons, that's also an important precedent. There are also incredibly important precedents on verification, important in those respects. But in terms of actual dollar savings to allow us the reallocation of resources of the kind I was describing today, it's far short of what we need. For that, we need to forego Star Wars, make deep cuts, but to do so on a verifiable basis that the other side is doing precisely the same thing.
Congressman Cheney, who was with you in the Soviet Union, comes from a frontier state with a pro-military electorate. Did his point of view shift towards a more open negotiating stance while he was there? And could you answer the same question with respect to Senator Simpson from the same state?
Well, Simpson wasn't with us. I don't know what his position is on this question. Mr. Cheney was the ranking Republican on the trip, and for that reason was in a position that I think you can identify with. He had the burden, the obligation, to pretty much be the spokesman of the administration. And to Jim Wright's credit, I want to parenthetically add that Jim Wright refrained from conducting any kind of congressional foreign policy with the Soviets while we were over there. It would have been unwise and foolish and totally improper to have done so, and he did not do so. Mr. Cheney's statements during the talks we had with the leaders basically was a restatement of the positions of the administration up to that point. So I really don't know what Mr. Cheney's own ideas are about how much of a chance we may have. I sense that it's a very real one, and I feel that had the general feeling as all of us left the Soviet Union that there was real change afoot there, and that it required from us new thinking, if not agreement on what the options were, at least new thinking of our strategy in dealing with this country.
Good afternoon, Les. Hi. Stan Baumhofer. Thank you for bringing a very positive hope to a reduction in the arms race. If we can have a substantial reduction in the arms race and thereby a reduction in our defense budget, would you predict that that reduction would be used to reduce the national debt or to reduce taxes or to fund other domestic and foreign programs?
Well, I think that we're in a position where we have to use it certainly first to reduce the national debt. If you look at the last 7 years at the big growth items in the federal budget, I'll tell you what they are. They are three things. They are defense, they are entitlements, and they are service on the national debt. Everything else in the federal budget has been trashed. It's really had a hatchet taken to it. So I think the first thing we need to do in order to get this massive binge of federal government borrowing under control that's making us increasingly at the mercy of foreign creditors is to use those savings to reduce the national debt. Having said that, I think it's also possible to, within those lower total aggregate budget levels, to rearrange some of the priorities in the programs we do choose to favor and ones we choose to perhaps fund to a lesser extent. And I think within that context, it's important to increase our commitment to education. Because as I look at our position in the world, I'm reminded of something I heard a lot of CEOs say at a recent National Academy of Sciences retreat, where CEOs and a few members of Congress and some academics were gathered, and he said something that I've agreed with and still agree with, and that is that as we face, as a country, foreign competition, America's competitive advantage is the intellectual capability of its workforce and the ability of its economy to put productive capital at work to produce the technology to put it in the hands of that workforce. I'd like to see the deficit reduced and rearrangement of some funding priorities to play to that comparative advantage.
Senator Bumpers is prepared to introduce an amendment to the defense authorization bill that would require the U.S. to abide by the SALT II limits unless the President certifies to Congress that the Soviet Union has exceeded those limits. What do you think of the chances of passage of that amendment by the Senate or by the House?
I think that Senator Bumpers' amendment is an extremely good amendment. We have breached the SALT II ceilings. Granted, this is not a treaty that's been ratified, but both sides have been living by these limits on the basis of a tacit understanding for a number of years. Our side decided to break out, and we've added a few cruise missiles that have put us over the limit. Unfortunately, that merely invites the Soviets to do the same thing. They have not done so yet. I think it would be prudent for Congress, which has the power of the purse strings, to use those purse strings to cut back funds enough to bring us back into compliance with the sublimits of the SALT II treaty and withdraw, if you will, the invitation we have extended to the Soviet Union by breaching that those limits to breach those limits themselves. This is very much like the anti-satellite test ban that I legislated through an amendment on the defense bill a couple of years ago, 3 years ago to be exact. Using the power of the purse strings, I denied funding and sold the Congress, and we signed it into law. It's been law for 3 years, that denies funding for flight testing of anti-satellites as long as the Soviets do not flight test as well, and it's easy to verify, and there are verification stipulations in the amendment. You want to know something? This is the only arms control up to this European agreement that's been achieved in the last 7 years. It was done congressionally through the power of the purse strings. But as of now, neither side is testing anti-satellite weapons against objects in space. And I think that makes both sides' satellites and both sides safer rather than more vulnerable. I think the Bumpers Amendment is a good amendment.
Yes, Don Wagner, member. Assuming that the Euromissile Agreement does go through, and let's say that the ICBM proposals that you elaborated, that can somehow happen. Is there something else that you would see that would come in between this, you say 2%, and something which I see as very substantial? Are there some intermediate steps or types of agreements that you would...
I think there are intermediate steps, and what that would be as you struck a bargain between Star Wars limitations to, say, research and deep cuts in the orders of magnitude that we're talking about would be a process of staging. Staged cuts, so many a year that are doable on each side, getting to 50% reduction in 5 years. I think that the staging gives you that transition that you're talking about, and I think that's what everyone who sees this as a potential outline of a bargain has in mind. It's certainly what I have in mind.
Changing our focus for a moment, Congressman, is there any chance of developing a consensus in Congress that military interference in the affairs of South and Central American countries usually causes more problems than it solves? It seems to me, the questioner, that our government would do better in using its efforts to help Mexico from becoming an economic basket case.
Well, let me answer the question this way. I think all of you know that I've been a critic of our Central American policy. To me, it makes no sense to win the hearts and minds, or try to, hearts and minds of Central Americans by backing the Contras, who are led by remnants of the Somoza regime. I mean, if there's one thing that people dislike more today than in Nicaragua than the Sandinistas, it would be the Somoza regime. For us to back them, I think, is really sending an incredibly poor signal to Central America. More than that, the Contras are not representing the kind of values or human rights standards that I think we ought to be fighting for and standing for. What we ought to be doing is what President Arias of Costa Rica has suggested recently, and I think if his plan succeeds, he should be granted the Nobel Peace Prize for his efforts. What Arias has said, after Wright, the Speaker, Jim Wright, and President Reagan sent down their own plan about ceasefire within 60 days and various kinds of stipulations. They said, thank you very much, but we have our own plan. And five Central American presidents collectively developed their own plan, calling for a ceasefire, calling for security guarantees of borders, calling for no intervention support for insurgencies within other states' borders, and no foreign military bases, and a number of other provisions. I think we should be behind that kind of diplomacy, because it's only that kind of diplomacy, not the force of a gun barrel from a mercenary army that doesn't have the popular support of the people, that will win and secure American interests in Central America. And those interests ought not to be just having a situation that doesn't rock the boat, that refrains from rocking the boat for America. What our interests really ought to be identified as being in Central America, it seems to me, is being at war, all right, but being at war with the three problems that cause the greatest amount of trouble, and that is ignorance and poverty and disease. And I think that kind of diplomacy gives us a chance to attack those problems and create a stability there that is, in fact, in America's self-interest.
Being a member of Congress means, by necessity, being a person of many hats. And one of the most important functions of a congressperson, perhaps, is one of informing us and keeping in touch with his constituents and letting us know his insights into the important issues of the day. We're grateful for the congressman for coming today and doing that for us. We know he has a very busy schedule, and we very much appreciate his taking the time to be here. We are adjourned.